Welcome to Let the Quran Speak. I'm Safiya, your host. A Saudi teen was given asylum in Canada after fleeing her family and country. Rahaf Mohammed gave up Islam, a crime that is punishable in Saudi law. She also wanted to live an independent life and be able to make decisions for herself. And she said that this was not possible under the country's system of guardianship. While much attention has focused on Saudi Arabia and Rahaf herself, little has been devoted to finding out whether the restrictions Rahaf faced have a basis in Islam. I sit down with Dr. Shabir Ally to discuss the religious aspects of the system of guardianship and of apostasy laws. Dr. Shabir Ally, welcome to Let the Quran Speak.
Pleasure to be on.
Now, much attention has focused on Rahaf Mohammed and in particular on the political nature of her acceptance in Canada. There was a public spat between Saudi Arabia and Canada, and some people feel like this story furthers that spat to Canada's benefit. Now, I don't want to talk about that. I want to talk more about the religious basis, because people might have questions about that. So I want to talk first about the guardianship system. We know that in Saudi Arabia, women need permission for any number of things when they're accessing government services. So they need permission to travel, to get married, to seek an education, to rent a property. So the question is, and sometimes the guardians that they have are not necessarily even older than them. So a woman could be married, or she could, you know, have a business of her own, but still she would need that guardian to do things for her. It could be her son who would have to seek permission for her. So the question is, where does that come from? Where does that guardianship system come from? Is it the Quran? Where is it?
A lot of this has to do with the cultural background of 7th century Arabia before Islam came on the scene. But when Islam came on the scene, not everything could be changed automatically and overnight. Things were gradual. But some interpretations of Islam tended to be frozen in time and tended to keep things as they were, or hope that things would be kept as they were, not looking. The interpreters did not look at the fact that the world is changing. And in fact, for many decades following the initial thrust of the Islamic message, things did remain quite stable. But in our present times, we see that society has evolved so much. We're now in the age of self-driving cars. So we have to not abandon anything that is essential to our faith, but we need to look at the items that are not essential to the core of Islam and see how these items can be reinterpreted to suit our present climate and the nature of people in our present society. We want to capture the original spirit, apply that in a modern way so that we do in fact capture that original spirit and not lose the objective and the purpose for which the commands were given.
When I think through this system of guardianship and I try to find what could be the source of this system, what I come back to is verse 434 in the Quran, which says, men are the protectors and maintainers of women. So that's the common translation. Maybe you can translate it better. But what does this have to do with the guardianship system? Can you tell me something about that?
Well, there are some connections. And what has happened in Saudi Arabia in particular is that this has been taken to an extreme. But at the core, this verse seems to be saying precisely that, literally, that men are the protectors and maintainers of women. But how might we interpret that today? Abdul Halim, in his translation, renders it such that the impression given is that men ought to be the protectors and maintainers of women. Now, we have to think of the ought here and see that what the Quran was doing initially was placing the responsibility on men to look after the female folk, especially in a traditional society in which women did not have the kinds of advantages and privileges that they have now. So they needed that protection. and support from their male relatives. And so men were given the responsibility to do that. But so that's the first thing. It doesn't mean that automatically men have something over and above women, like by nature, though some interpreters said that. And they tried to see, oh, what is it by nature that makes men somehow superior to women? And some even mentioned the silly observation that, oh, men have beards and women don't. What is that? What does that have to do with anything?
Well, people commonly say women are deficient in their reasoning power.
Well,
right?
They went that in that direction, yes, as well. And more than this, there's a verse in the Quran which says, "La tusufaha amwalakum," do not give your wealth to the foolish ones. And what was meant here is not literally foolish, but children who are underage, and you're protecting their wealth for them. Or they might be in society, some persons who need a legal guardian or caretaker to look after his or her wealth, because maybe they're mentally somehow not all the way there. But then the interpreters went to work and they said that this means women as well. Mm-hmm. As if women somehow are mentally deficient and men have to take care of all aspects of their lives, including their financial affairs. So these are interpretations gone bad. And we need to go back to the core teachings and see that when the Quran said that men are protectors and maintainers of women, that was placing a responsibility on them when that responsibility was needed. But when women come of age, their own age in that time, or even now when women more generally are leaders and presidents and prime ministers of countries, it's not right for us to maintain that men have to somehow be protectors of women. Because while there's a good side to that, the negative side is that it keeps women in society in a dependent status. Mm-hmm. And that is not good for the progress of societies in general.
Yeah, but the problem is we're left with this verse, right, which says in its plain meaning that men are the protectors and maintainers of women. So everyone can refer back to that verse at any time and say, you know, the Quran says that this is the way it should be.
That's why it is important in modern times that we teach Muslims not only to memorize the Quran, as has been our practice for centuries, but also to understand the Quran against its historical context and to understand the application of the Quran in a modern context.
Mm-hmm. Now, what about the apostasy laws? Can you tell me something about that?
Well, classical interpretations basically said that the apostate should be killed, but many modern interpreters look at the hadith the hadiths that refer to this, and say that there were more to these hadiths than just simply the question of apostasy. It was also like reneging from the community, which posed a military danger to the early Muslim communities, and it is for that reason that the apostate was to be killed, not simply for leaving the religion, because obviously you cannot force a person to remain within the religion, and the Quran itself gives no penalty to be administered in this world against the apostate. The Quran promises dreadful penalties in the life hereafter for those who renege on the faith. But as for compulsion within this life, the Quran says, La ikraha fid din, in the second chapter, the 256th verse. So that's the governing principle. There can be no compulsion in religion. So there's no penalty to be administered in this world for the apostate. And since the Quran is so clear on the matter, we should not accept a verdict that is contrary to the Quran.
How about the Prophet Muhammad? Did he ever kill anybody for leaving Islam?
There are narratives outside of the Quran which might give that impression. But again, those who would want to revise this are looking at it and saying that no, it's not simply for the fact that they reneged on Islam, but these are persons who, in addition to reneging from Islam, they used their outside status to kill Muslims. Mm-hmm. And so it was in return for their killing of Muslims that they were killed as a sort of capital punishment. Again, we should say that the Quran is the governing principle, and people who narrated these incidents concerning the life of the Prophet, peace be upon him, could have made mistakes in the way they narrated this, because much of what we know, in fact, all of what we know from the biography of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, all of the little details in his life were passed on orally by word of mouth from one generation to another until they were finally finally written down in the collections that we have them now. The earliest biography we have is that of Ibn Ishaq, who died in the year 150 approximately. And his book, in fact, did not even come down to us intact. We have a recension of it done by Ibn Hisham, who died in the early part of the 3rd century. So we have materials that were circulated in a way that they could have changed over time, whereas the Quran, on the other hand, was written down and memorized right from the very inception. So what we have in the Quran is absolutely dependable for Muslims as the Word of God, and that should remain the governing principle. When it is clear on a matter, we should not accept a contrary verdict from any other source.
Mm-hmm. Now, we're talking about apostasy at the state level, but I guess I have another question, which is, what should our attitude be towards someone who leaves Islam on a social level? Let's say it's you know, your brother or your sister. In the case of Rahad, you know, how should her family relate to her, because she was concerned about that?
Yeah, there was a time in which ostracism would have worked to the benefit of bringing the person back in. Somebody's wayward, you show a very harsh response to that, and the person might actually come back into the fold because of that. But nowadays, if you use that treatment, you just isolate people more. I mean, I wish the family would have issued a message that said something like, Rahaf, we love you, you are our flesh and blood, there's been a misunderstanding, but please come back, let's work things out, you are, you know, one of us, and we're sorry that it's come to this, we didn't realize it was going this far. Come back and let's work something out. We love you.
Yes, the letter that they sent was very antagonistic.
Yeah, cutting her off, and then she drops her family name. That doesn't lead to any good.
Thank you for that, Dr. Shabir.
You're welcome.
Hey, YouTube. We hope you benefited from this video. If you liked it, or if you didn't, let us know in the comments below. And if you're interested in learning more, check out some of our other videos. And don't forget to subscribe so you can get new videos every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday.